In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good evening. It's such a privilege to do Bible class, and I'm grateful to God for it. As usual, it's Wednesday, and today we shall study chapter 18. Chapter 18 is a blueprint of how Christians should live in this life. The greatest in the kingdom of heaven. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Who then is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" Jesus called a little child to him, placed the child among them. You know, public memory is generally short. You remember in chapter 11, Jesus had already told them who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Remember when John the Baptist was being discussed, Jesus had said there is none greater than John the Baptist, and yet he had said that the greatest in the kingdom of heaven is as a little child. But they had forgotten, and they ask him again. It happens to all of us, including you, I'm sure. You're seeing the Bible class, one class after another, and yet you might forget the past. I have already explained this in chapter 11, which was explained fully in Bible study number 22. You know, this explanation of Jesus is a lesson in humility. And so that his disciples would never forget, he demonstrated it by enacting his explanation by placing a little child in front of them. Normally when we demonstrate like that, no, we give a demonstration, it remains in the memory for a long time. That's why he placed the child before them and showed them. But why a little child? You know, Jesus is using the child as a metaphor, or like an example, how we can be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. If we have the qualities, the childlike qualities of a child, we will surely enter the kingdom of God. You know, here when Jesus says child or little one, there are two meanings. One is the little meaning, that is the child itself. And the other is metaphorical, like the qualities that a human being should have, like that of a child to enter the kingdom of heaven. So let's look at the qualities of a child. You know, a child is always, he has that power to wonder. And he looks at things, he's so amazed. Yeah, he's open. He's absorbing everything like a sponge. He doesn't have preconceived notions. And a child has a tendency to forgive and to forget in a brilliant way. I'll explain that later. And the child has innocence because he has yet to learn so many things. He doesn't know a lot of things. He's innocent. But the four greatest qualities of a child are, you know, first, trust. He has immense trust in his parents. He knows where his food is going to come from. His parents are going to give him food when he's hungry. He knows that he'll get clothes. He knows that when he travels, he doesn't have to worry about paying for the ticket or the accommodation or whatever. And he gets warmth from his parents. He knows he'll get it. He'll get shelter. They will care for him. He knows that. He has immense trust in his parents. That is the literal meaning. And the metaphorical meaning is, do we trust God enough, like the child, in everything, in food, in clothes, in a house, travel, warmth, money, security, whatever. Do we trust enough in God? The child has that quality. That's the first quality of a child. The second is humility. A child is always humble. He doesn't want to go ahead. Yeah. It's only when we actually put him into school or we as we're raising him, we compare him to other children, that this sense of competitiveness comes in and we ruin the child's humility. He's always a child when he is not exposed to competition. He always loves to remain in the shade or in the arms or in the bosom of his mother. Yeah. He has no ego. He doesn't have a sense of, you know, what is self or his ego. Yeah? He doesn't have pride. That is the literal one, meaning of the child's qualities. What is the metaphorical then? Do we as human beings forgo our ego and are we willing to be last? For the last will be first and the first will be last. It is our ego that gives us a sense of importance, that makes us feel hurt when somebody talks against us. The third quality is dependence, total surrender. A child, you know, he totally submits to his parents. He never thinks that he can face life on his own. He knows, I don't have to worry about anything. I totally surrender myself to my parents. They put me to sleep, I go to sleep. They wake me up, I waken up. Whatever I do, whatever they tell me and whichever way they guide me, I go with them. I trust them. I'm dependent on them. Yeah. So, but do we actually surrender ourselves to God's will? No. We want our will to be done. We act as if we have made this world and the whole world shall conform to what we desire. Nah, that will not work. And the last is forgiveness. The quality of a child is to forgive. Forgive the tyranny and the hypocrisy of the parents. The child is small. He doesn't understand why the parents are beating him up when he has raised his hand on another child. Aren't the parents doing the same thing what he has done? Or when the parents beat up the child for using a bad word or an expletive or an abuse, zip word, when they themselves are abusing at home, they abuse each other at home. And yet they beat them up. Sometimes when the spouse is angry on a husband or the husband is angry on the wife, to take out anger, they beat up the child and the child doesn't even know why he is being beaten up. This is tyranny. And yet the child forgives and forgets. He comes back to them. He has no sense of anger, hatred. He is willing to forgive. We too need to learn to forgive. That is the only way we can be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven, or maybe be denizens or citizens of the kingdom of heaven. Actually, a person who resides in the kingdom of heaven has completely forgotten the sense of self. He has no importance. He has no sense of self-importance. And he lives to serve. And he doesn't live for ambition. He doesn't want to be this, that, or the other. He just wants to serve the world as long as he is alive in this world. That person is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. We'll read from verse 5. And whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. Why does Jesus say that? Again, literally and metaphorically. Here, what Jesus wants to say is, we must be kind and careful with children. That is the literal meaning. But the hidden meaning or the metaphorical meaning is, whoever comes into our faith and is new, like a child who is baptized or an adult who is baptized, we have to treat them like little children so that they can trust us, and through us they can trust God, that they can depend on us, that we'll always be there for them, so that they learn that they are dependent on God, that they learn to forgive from looking at us like how we forgive. Yeah. And also it can also mean that whoever welcomes a missionary, you know, when he's going around in total service, a missionary has no ambition. He only has the objective of serving humanity. Yeah. So we'll go next. Verse 6, causing to stumble. If anyone causes one of these little ones who believe in me to stumble, it will be better for them to have a large millstone hung around their neck and to be drowned in the depths of the sea. Woe to the world because of the things that cause people to stumble. Such things must come, but woe to the person through whom they come. This is real condemnation. That means the responsibility on us is even greater. We must make sure that we do not cause anybody else to sin. If we do, then Jesus says not to tie a millstone, but a large millstone. The millstone that people use in the houses was small, but this is a large millstone. If you take the Greek root word of what is used in the original manuscripts. It is moulos onikos. Moulos means millstone and onikos means for an ass. That means it's a big mill, and this millstone is huge, and an ass labors to take it round and round. Yeah. But why does Jesus say woe to the world because of the things that cause people to stumble? Woe to the person through whom they come. Why is Jesus so harsh? I'll tell you. You know, mostly we learn to sin from others, from what we see or whatever. That is why the most unforgivable sin is to teach others to sin. I'll tell you. Why? I'll explain to you. See, a man can remember his own sin and seek forgiveness for it, right? But if he teaches another person to sin, he and that other person in turn might teach many others, and they in turn teach many and many others, setting off a chain reaction. How can he seek forgiveness? So many people have been infected with this sin. Look at what's happening on WhatsApp today. One wrong post, one malicious, scandalous post that assassinate somebody's character, and it goes all over the world. So when you teach others to sin, that's why Jesus is so harsh on it. I hope you understand. Verse 8, if your hand or your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life maimed or crippled than to have two hands or two feet and be thrown into the eternal fire. You know, many people take this literally. Pluck out your eye or cut your hand. No, you are not to take this literally. Yet it is worth any sacrifice and self-renunciation to gain the kingdom of heaven. It is worth much more than this body. You know, I watched a movie called Men of Honor. It stars Cuba Gooding Jr. and Robert De Niro. It's a true story of Master Chief Petty Officer Carl Brashear, the first African-American master diver in the United States Navy. He became a hero in spite of all the odds. And you know, in recovering a missing hydrogen bomb and saving the lives of Navy crewmen, his left leg got badly mangled. And as a result, it was hampering his performance as the master diver. So what did he decide? He says, as long as I have this mangled leg that I am laboring to carry when I am down in the depths of the sea, it's better I amputate it so I can do my job better. So what did he do? He went and amputated his left leg so that he could be the diver that he wanted to be. But you know, I want to tell you, Jesus is not asking us to be self-destructive physically. He is speaking metaphorically, because the flesh amounts to nothing. The spirit is everything. The flesh will only last up to the grave. The spirit is timeless, it is eternal. If your eye causes you to stumble, gouge it out and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life with one eye than to have two eyes and be thrown into the fire of hell. You remember in my previous videos, I have explained to you the temporal world and the eternal world. That is the worldly life versus the spiritually heavenly life. You remember? I told you that the temporal world ends in the grave, and after that there's nothing for those who don't believe in the eternal world. And those who believe in the eternal world, death is not to be feared, for it is only a bridge that crosses over from the worldly life into the eternal life. That's what Jesus is saying. So don't take it literally. You're not supposed to gouge your eyes if you see something, something bad or evil. It is better for you to enter life with one eye than to have two eyes and be thrown into the fire of hell. The word used here is Jehenna in Hebrew. Jehenna, or in Hindi and Urdu we call it Jahannam, is hell. It got its name from the Valley of Hinnom, Jehinnom. The Valley of Hinnom is very just off Jerusalem, in the valley there. And it became infamous. It became known as hell because the Jews, the Israelites, suddenly turned to the pagan god Moloch and started sacrificing children. So Josiah was so angered, he condemned that place and cursed it. And it remained just like that. And you know, like you have that kachreka dump being stored and thrown at one place, that valley that valley of Hinnom became a refuse dump. All the Jews, all the people from Jerusalem would throw the refuse there. And there would be a fire lit up so that the refuse was constantly burning into cinders, you know, into ash. That's how it got its name, Jehannam. That's what would happen in hell. All those who were useless would be thrown into the fire. Because everything useless in Jerusalem was thrown into that kachreka heap or that refuse dump. Yeah? So that's where hell, the word for hell is Jehannam. The parable of the wandering sheep. See that you do not despise one of these little ones. For I tell you that there are angels in heaven always see the face of my Father in heaven. Now verse 11 is empty, but let me explain verse 10. See, all these little ones, again, the little meaning is the real child itself. Do not despise the child. Or metaphorically, do not despise a newcomer comes into your fold or into the church. Do not despise him. Do not look down upon him that he was a pagan once and now he's come. Because Jesus says, for I tell you that angels in heaven always see the face of my Father in heaven. So they are angels. Everybody has a guardian angel. So they are angels. We can directly communicate with God and tell what you are doing to the little one or the beginner in faith. Now verse 11 is empty, but I want to tell you, not all Bibles show verse 11 as empty. It's only the study Bibles and the advanced Bibles that show it as empty. Whereas, elementary Bibles, like even the Good News, they might not show this empty. Or they will write it in parenthesis, they will write a footnote that this verse actually is now empty. What do you think? If a man owns 100 sheep and one of them wanders away, will he not leave the 99 on the hills and go to look for the one that wandered off? I'll have to explain to you, take you back 2000 years in Palestine. You know, most of Judea was actually, their pasture was on a plateau. And at the edge, there were ravines that just had a sheer drop. So many times these people, used to take their sheep. The sheep would wander off and go to the edge and try to go down, and the ravine was pretty steep. So they'd get stuck on a ledge, these sheep, foolish as sheep can be. And there, they couldn't go down nor come up. So they'd just be there and starve and die. Most of this flock of sheep were communal flocks. They belonged to the entire village. So they had about two or three of these shepherds tending to them. That is why the shepherd could leave the 99 behind and go looking for the one. If it was not so, and he left the 99 and he went looking for one, many from the 99 would have got lost. You understand? So when I was young, I used to think, oh, he left all the 99 and he went looking for one. The point is not that. Those 99 are not neglected. They are taken care of by the other shepherds. And this guy goes looking for the sheep. And if it's a wolf that has attacked this sheep or taken him, then he will fight the wolf at the risk to his own life. For the shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. So what, the rule was in the village, the villagers would tell the shepherds, if any sheep is lost, you can go looking for it. And if it has been killed, at least get us the fleece or the bones so that we can know that this sheep was accounted for. So that's how the good shepherd would go looking for the sheep. And if we found him dead, he would carry him back. Sometimes it would take a lot of time to locate the sheep because the area was vast. Like I was thinking, God loves sinners and he neglects all of us and he goes looking for one sinner. What about us? No, it's not like that. God always has his eye on us, but he loves sinners. That's what Jesus says. But the love of God, in the metaphor of the good shepherd, I'll explain it to you. The love of God is shown in this example of the good shepherd. Let's look at it. God loves us patiently. He's got a lot of patience. Generally, see, sheep are always foolish. Sheep are foolish animals. They would all do things that an intelligent animal wouldn't do. A shepherd would still risk his life for this foolish sheep. And generally men have little patience dealing with fools. But God is not like that. is patient and kind, like the good shepherd. No wonder Jesus laid down his life for us. Many of us can be totally foolish and succumb to temptations. The second thing is, God loves each one of us individually. That's why Jesus gave the example of the 99. The 99 were not enough. That one sheep that had wandered off, the shepherd would go looking for it, because every sheep mattered. You know, there was an old mother who had 18 children, all grown up. And whenever the family met, she used to grieve constantly over the one child she had lost 30 years ago. Even on a happy occasion, she would miss that one child whom she had lost 30 years ago. God is like that. He cannot be happy until the last lost sheep is found. That's why Jesus gives this example of the 100 sheep and the one sheep that is lost. And God seeks us to love us. He wants to love us, so He tries to search for us. That's what the shepherd does. The shepherd in this parable was not content waiting for the lost sheep to return. He went out looking for it over the ravines and slopes. And also, the love of God is a rejoicing love. You know, when we come back to God, or when the sheep is found, the shepherd is full of joy. He is so happy that the sheep is found. Same thing with God. When we come back to God, God is happy. That's what Jesus tells us. That's why He calls God Abba, Father, like our Father. So the metaphor of the Good Shepherd clearly shows us the amount of love God has for each one of us. So we have even the Feast of the Good Shepherd. You know, today we've come to learn so many character traits of the Good Shepherd. If your brother or sister sins, go and point out their fault just between the two of you. If they listen to you, you have won them over. Whenever somebody hurts you, many people have a thing that they'll keep it in their heart and they'll brood over it. It is fatal to brood over the pain someone has caused you, because it will fester and poison your mind to such an extent that you will think of nothing else but your sense of personal injury that person has done to you. Such a feeling or such a thought should be brought face to face. Go to the person who hurt you. Go to him and talk to him about it. Tell him that I feel hurt. Don't say I'm angry. Say I feel hurt that you did this to me. Why did you do this? And once you bring it face to face, suddenly you might even realize that the whole thing was a trivial thing. It was not worth expending our mental energies on it. And why do we need to go face to face, just between the two of you, like Jesus says? Face to face. Why? Not by writing or WhatsApp or by telephone. You remember in my previous Bible study, number 26, when I was trying to interpret the healing of the Canaanite woman's daughter, I told you about communications. How communication is only 7% words, 38% paralanguage, the way you say it, 55% body language. So when you go face to face, you express yourself more clearly and cogently. But if they will not listen to you, take one or two others along, so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. This verse actually comes from Deuteronomy chapter 19, verse 15. But you know, the meaning of this is, when you take two or three witnesses, you are not taking those witnesses as witnesses against them, but you are taking them for reconciliation, so that you build a bridge with that person who's not listening to you. And also, there's a very important reason. You know, man generally hates those whom he has hurt, and he will not be open to them. He doesn't want to look at them, doesn't want to talk to them. That's why this failed. When he went face to face, it failed. So what he does is, in such a scenario, it's better to take along someone respectable, two or three respectable people with you, might not be posing a barrier to that other person who has hurt you, and thus you might be able to solve the problem. But if they still refuse to listen to these two or three respectable people, tell it to the church. And if they refuse to listen even to the church, treat them as you would a pagan or a tax collector. You know, many people interpret this as saying that if they don't listen to you, just treat them like pagans and tax collectors. Just let them be. Forget about them. Ignore them. No, that's not what Jesus meant. You have seen always Jesus is siding with the tax collector and the pagans and the sinners. He will not talk something that is contrary to what he has been talking so far. What Jesus is saying is, even if they don't listen to you, doesn't mean that they are lost. Treat them like the way I treat a tax collector, I treat a pagan, you know, I treat a sinner. Forgive. That's what it means. But many people say, hey, treat him like a pagan, forget him. No, no, no. That's not what Jesus can say. Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. I've already explained this to you in my previous Bible study. Yeah? This is being repeated here. Again, truly I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything they ask for, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. You know, many people misconstrue this, you know, saying that Jesus has said that two or three people gather and they ask for something and agree about anything they ask for. Two or three people might agree on something very bad, you know, very sinful. God will not listen to them. You're not supposed to take this literally. You know why? Because if you tell someone and he believes it hook, line and sinker, what will happen? His faith in God will decrease. You're not to take this literally. Many times prayers are not answered. And you feel so distraught and disappointed that God has not heard your prayers. But why are prayers not answered? Let's have a look. I just want to tell you straight off the bat. Selfish prayers are never answered. Now what is a selfish prayer? It's when we think of our own interests when we pray that we are selfish. This world was not made only for us individually, but it was made for all of mankind, correct? Oftentimes, if our prayers were answered, the prayers of someone else would have led to disappointment for him, right? For example, suppose your son is going for an interview and your neighbor's son also is going for an interview for the same job in the same company. And you're praying that your son may get the job and your neighbor is praying that his son may get the job. Now you tell me, to answer your prayers, God will have to disappoint somebody else, right? That's not the way how God works. I remember when I was a boy, I used to play, you know, in ballet pier. And in my building, in the ground floor, there was a Daruka Adda, you know, a bootlegging joint. They used to serve country liquor there, illegal, not licensed. And there was another, in the adjacent building, there was another Daruka Adda. And both of these guys were friends of mine. So when I used to go in the morning and just pay a visit to my friends, I used to see my friend in the other building using a bell and taking agarbatti and, you know, worshipping his God and asking for what? That his Daruka Adda should succeed. In order that so many families would be ruined because the man of the house would go there and get drunk and become an alcoholic. The same thing would happen in my building. And this guy was also again praying, and he was praying more arduously, you know, and praying for what? That his business may succeed and that other guy's business may go down. Yeah? You've seen the IPL. I've seen, you know, when Kings 11 Punjab was playing Rajasthan Royals. I've seen both Preeti Zinta praying fervently and Shilpa Shetty praying fervently. To answer Shilpa's prayer, God would have to disappoint Preeti. That's not the way God works. These type of prayers are selfish prayers. They are called selfish prayers. They are never answered. God doesn't answer this. How can, when India and Pakistan are playing a cricket match, all the Indians are praying for victory and the Pakistanis are praying for victory. Whom does God listen to? No, they are selfish prayers. Often our prayers are for success, our success. So unselfish prayer is always answered. You remember this. Always answered. Unselfish prayer. But there's a golden rule in prayer. That when we pray, we will receive not the answer we humanly desire, but the best answer from the wisdom and love of God. What God knows is best for us. Don't you trust God? As humans, most of our prayers are prayers for escape from suffering, escape from disease, disappointment, hurt. Most of our prayers are prayers for healing. But God's answer is not for escape from disease, from suffering, from disappointment. God's answer is not for escape, but for overcoming all these things, for overcoming. God enables us to accept what we do not understand. God enables us to endure what without Him would be unendurable. God enables us to face the impossible. Remember Gethsemane? And Jesus was praying. He was pleading with God to let the cup pass away from him. The dread that was going to happen, he wanted it to be avoided. But God did something greater. He gave the power and the grace to our Lord Jesus Christ to die with dignity on the cross so that mankind would be saved. So when we pray unselfishly, God answers our prayers, but it is His answer, not ours, not the answer we expect. Verse 20, for where two or three gather in my name, there I am with them. You know, I've seen that when we have a collective, you know, when we pray together, for example, congregational prayers like charismatic meetings, you know, praise and worship gatherings, We can actually feel that our faith is getting edified by the faith of the people around us. It is so contagious, you know. It swirls around faith, you know. Faith swirls around and increases manifold. It is electric. I know I have been to Pota and I am not a very good, you know, I can't get into an ecstasy of prayer. Maybe I'm a measured guy, but there, you know, after the initial lethargy, I was lethargic in praise and worship. It came. I started praising and worshiping God, and I felt good. Then also, where two or three are gathered in my name, also means your family, husband, wife, and child, or whatever. So when you pray, God's grace comes upon you. And because it comes upon you, it comes on the others also who are with you. And you remember the adage, a family that prays together stays together. The parable of the unmerciful servant. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to seven times? See Peter, how he is. He wants to show off that he knows Jesus very, very well. You know why? I'll tell you why. As for the Old Testament, every time God gave a chance to His people, He gave them three chances. Only three chances. Fourth time, He would destroy them. It's not that God's patience was thin. That's how it was mentioned in the Old Testament. Here, Peter, what does he do? He knows it's only three times you can forgive. Because he knows Jesus, he adds another three because Jesus loves everybody. And I have to add to all that, he also adds one more to make it seven. And he says, up to seven times, he asked Jesus. You know, because of Peter, Jesus spoke so many wonderful things. And we must be eternally grateful to Peter because he made wonderful things come out of the mouth of Jesus. Now Peter asks him that question. See what will happen as a result of that question. Jesus will explain to us how many times we should forgive, and He will do it with a wonderful parable. The parable of the unmerciful servant. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to 7 times? Jesus answered, I tell you, not 7 times, but 77 times. Jesus is telling Peter that not 7 times, but 70. In the old Bibles, you know, in the old translations, it's 70 times 7. But in the newer translations, it's 77 times. Somebody changed the math. If it was 70 times 7, it would be 490 times for the same sin. And here in this newer translation, it's given as only 77 times. But that is not important. Of course, Jesus did not mean that we should stop forgiving after 490 times, or we should stop forgiving even after 77 times. He meant that there should be no limits to our forgiveness. In short, forgiveness must be unconditional and infinite. That's what Jesus meant. Yeah? So he told us to forgive for the same sin 77 times, or 70 times 7. I'll read further. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. At this, the servant fell on his knees before him. Be patient with me, he begged, and I will pay back everything. The servant's master took pity on him, cancelled the debt, and let him go. But when that servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins. He grabbed him and began to choke him. Pay back what you owe me, he demanded. His fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, be patient with me and I will pay it back. But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were outraged and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. You wicked servant, he said. I cancelled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you? In his anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all that he owed. This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart. See how Jesus uses this parable. He uses extremes. The servant owed the master 10,000 bags of gold. Maybe that was the wages for about 200 years. If he had worked for 200 years, he might have got that much amount of money. And 100 silver coins was equal to 100 days' wages. That's all. So the others, when this servant was forgiven 200 days of wages worth of debt, he could not forgive his fellow servant 100 days of wages debt that he had taken. There is something so immense in this. When our countless sins are being forgiven, can't we forgive others their minor sins? How can we be so blind to the quality of God, His forgiving nature? So the moral of the story is a man must forgive in order to be forgiven. And there's one more thing, one more reason why prayers are not answered. And I did it last week with Mark chapter 11 verses 22 to 25. And he says, believe what you're praying for, you have already received. But then in the next sentence, Jesus says, unless you forgive, your prayers will not be answered. To summarize chapter 18, the first part was the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. It was a lesson in humility. Then number 2 was teaching others to sin is a grave offense. That's what Jesus says, tells us. Point number 3 is self-renunciation to attain the kingdom of heaven. Gouge your eyes out or cut your hand. Your body is not more important than your soul. Number 4, God is the good shepherd. He is loving, kind, merciful. He has patience, even though we are foolish. Number 5 is correcting the erring Christian. you correct him, you tell him if he's hurt, you tell him nicely, try to correct him. If he doesn't listen, so be it. Number six, the value of fellowshipping and praying together. I already told you about Pota and charismatic meetings and many of these services of the church. And last, forgiveness is a must. If you want your sins forgiven, you must forgive others. That's all, folks. That ends Matthew chapter 18. Until next Wednesday, 7 p.m. God bless. Praise God. Don't forget to like, subscribe, share and comment. Please share it with as many people as possible. Thank you. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Praise God.